You are now tuned to the interview. Is it called the interview? What's it called?
Ubunifu Extra.
Ubunifu Extra.
I like that. Extra. Yeah. Hey, y'all coming up. Y'all got the extra channel.
With me, Shay Sade, from the Ubunifu space. So today I am in Peckham, South London. I'm currently in Sunset Studio and I'm going to be speaking to one of South Africa's biggest hip hop artists right now. He's known for his style, his swag, his lyrics, his bars, and he's also known as King Katini. If you haven't guessed by now, I'm going to be talking to Riky Rick. So, hi Riky, how are you?
I'm good, how are you?
I'm good. Oh, what's that?
What's up?
How do you do it?
No, it's just a shake. Yes.
Okay.
It's too much. It's too much.
It's too much? What does that mean?
It's too much. It's too much crazy means like... You feel me?
No, I don't feel you. I don't understand. Is that like...
It's too much is like it's the best, yes. It's too much is the best.
It's the best?
It's the best.
Okay.
Yes.
Do that again.
Yeah. No. Come with the thumb. Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, come with the thumb. Hold up. Come with the thumb. Yeah.
Oh, and then we do that.
It's too much.
It's too much. That's what's up. That's what's up. I saw you partying last night on Instagram.
Well, me?
Yes, you.
Yeah, no. Might have done a few things. It was my boy's birthday.
Yeah.
So we went out around the town.
How's the London light scene?
I think London's nice, man. It's like it's a different vibe, you know.
Yeah.
It's a bit more serious than back home. But
really?
Yeah, it's like things like.
It's a bit more bougie, basically.
I don't know, it's like bouncers are serious, and it's like, we don't like, at clubs at home,
yeah.
There's nobody who can tell you can't come in the club.
Oh, really?
You know what I'm saying? There's no like, you're not coming in tonight, like everybody's going in, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it's like, yeah, it's like, yo, wait to speak to this guy, you know, so it's different.
Right? I guess it's London's quite a bougie type of scene where it's, they try and, be like, what's the thing where you try and get certain people in, certain people are seen certain people.
Exactly.
So I guess that's what they're practicing there.
Yeah.
Is it your first time being in South London?
Yeah, first time. I was here like when I was a teenager, but it's been a while. So yeah, first time as an adult, yeah.
And first time in London or not?
Yeah, first time in London. It's actually too much. It's actually too much.
Really? It's too much. Too much. You're looking swagged out today, as I can see. I mean, can we get a little zoom in the outfits?
No, this is my pajamas.
This is your pajamas? Okay.
These ones are the pajamas. I just woke up, you know?
You just woke up?
I'm just like, yo.
You go bed dressed like this?
Yeah, daily paper connect, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I might have not showered yet either.
Okay.
That still smells good, you feel me?
So I'm seeing it says Daily Paper and Riky Rick. So is this your label? Or is this like a collaboration?
Daily Paper is a brand from Netherlands.
Okay.
Like it's a group of like kids basically from Netherlands.
Yeah.
Mostly with African background.
Mm-hmm.
And then they started their brand and I just like got a crazy relationship. So they just did a set.
Yeah. Nice. So in an interview I saw, you said that Durban gangsters like to wear Italian clothes.
Yeah.
So explain that to me a little bit.
Well, not necessarily only gangsters. I mean, just like Durban, we have a culture of like, you know, like, you know, you want to wear like the best, you know what I'm saying? And in a lot of hoods in South Africa, but Durban specifically, it's like, yo, you had to be like, nice.
That kid out flying, yeah.
Like, you gotta be nice, you know, you're coming with the cavellas, you know, some loafers, you know what I'm saying? Some pants with the belt, maybe you're coming with the shirt, you know, some silk stuff, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That was like the vibe, yeah.
I do see you're a big fan of Gucci.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if you had to choose one brand to like wear forever, would it be Gucci, Versace, or Dolce & Gabbana?
It would probably have to be Gucci.
Yeah. What would you love about Gucci so much? What's your love for Gucci?
I mean, like growing up, like I said, like I always wanted to like, because we didn't have Gucci in South Africa.
Mm.
So a lot of brands like made like their version of Italian clothes, you know?
Yeah.
And like for years, that's like what that's what like we've been taught. Like,
yes.
This is what Italy looks like, you know?
Yeah.
You might have seen like pictures on the internet, like you might have seen like kids, Scottanes, Okay. Dressing like almost like Versace patterns.
Okay.
But they like they dress in like outrageous colors. Then they come in with the sort of like Italian shoes with a little bit of a platform and stuff like that. Those cotanas, mm-hmm. like that comes from like us having like a culture of like wanting Italian clothes. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So I always wanted like Italian clothes, and then now that I made a little bit of cheese, I was like, yo, let me actually start getting some Italian clothes, some really Italian clothes.
So if I went into your wardrobe now,
yeah.
would I just see purely Italian clothes? Will I see anything normal, like let's say H&M?
No, not H&M specifically. You'll see normal stuff, but like you'll see fun little tracksuits, a lot of you know, chill stuff, but not H&M. Like I don't believe in like fast fashion. So like rather like have it being like a Nike or an Adidas or something.
Yeah.
But like fast fashion like messes up the environment.
Right, okay.
So like it's like have you ever bought like an H&M t-shirt?
Yeah.
And then washed it?
Yeah.
And then it washed. No, first time you wash it is good. Second time you wash it.
It goes a bit.
No, it's still good.
Okay, yeah.
Then the third time, if you wash it the third time, it's gone now. Now you're getting those little balls on your t-shirt now.
Yeah, it starts to get a bit sweet.
Exactly.
Well,
you know what I'm saying?
And so, I have to go buy another one.
So you'd rather you just stick to sportswear brands or you go all the way out.
You're in London for your headline show.
Yeah.
On the 19th of August. So hopefully by the time this goes up, you perform. How are you feeling to perform to a London crowd?
I think it's dope, man. Like I'm on a little bit of a mini European tour right now. Mm-hmm. So like what I realized, like it's fucking scary. Because like you don't know how much of the music people know.
Yeah.
So like it's really scary, but it's dope. Like as soon as you get on, people just feel the vibe.
Yeah, they feel it.
Yeah, so performing, I mean, it's gonna be dope performing in front of like the London people, you know?
Yeah.
Cause we always get like, we got like a group of Zimbabweans and Nigerians and people from other African countries in Johannesburg, but they like familiar with the stuff.
Right,
so
okay.
It's gonna be different like going to like another community that's inside London, you know? So that's gonna be crazy.
Do you ever like pinch yourself when you realize how much your music travels like across the world, not even just in South Africa?
Sort of, yeah. I mean, because I'm an internet kid, I expect the internet to pick up the music.
Yeah.
You know, it's disappointing when the internet doesn't pick up the music, but like when you meet someone on the street or somebody like you walking past and they tell you that they like this song or that song, it's like really like a fulfilling feeling.
Right.
Because you know it's hitting somewhere. You know people are listening to it somewhere else other than where you are, but you just don't know who those people are.
It is.
So when you get to know who those people are, it's like it really fills that feeling.
Mm-hmm. And you know, you've had quite a busy year at the moment. Recently as well, the family video is out.
Yeah.
I saw on YouTube it's kind of got like 181, probably 1,000 views, probably higher now. How does it feel like to see such a response to like your video? Does it ever get?
Well, those videos, which is crazy, I haven't actually dropped a song of my own in like a while, and like probably over a year. Mm-hmm. But what I've been doing is like doing features for like younger artists and putting on like my younger kids. So like Frank Casino is like one of my young guns. So I was like putting him on. So like the whole thing remix. Like I heard the song and I was like, let me do a remix of it, and then I shot the video for him. And then family's the same thing. Like he had the song and I was like, yo, I'll jump on, let's do a verse, you know. So it's just about, for me, it's like really about putting on the youngest right now.
Yeah, I did see that you made it your mission in a way to kind of really push out those that are yet to be seen and heard within the music scene and stuff like that.
I think like what more am I gonna do, you know?
Yeah.
It's like I can do much more and I can run like even a bit further. Mm-hmm. But it's like the further I run, it's like that you get this group of kids that are like down here.
Right.
And the more that I keep going up, they like, this gap is just like filled with anger, you know what I'm saying? Like, why is he doing, why is he going overseas? Or why is he getting these deals or whatever? And then they get angry and then eventually they're like, they're gonna fuck you up. Like they're gonna be doing diss records for you all day. So I'm like, I don't wanna be one of those artists in a South African scope or an African scope, anything, to like leave behind the other guys with talent. I don't want to be one of those guys. I want to bring all of those kids up.
It's quite noble of you, because I kind of feel like that's not really something I hear a lot from artists, to want to genuinely put other artists on. It's more like every man for themselves, I need to get this money.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what you hear in music. It's like, I need to get this money and do my thing. So, I mean, would you say that you was given a helping hand when you were making music?
No, like I didn't get any helping hand. That was the hardest thing about it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And all the people that could have helped me, like, are basically, like, gone. They disappeared. They don't have a legacy, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's more important, like, you need to do it for, like, the legacy, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And, like, every artist has his turn. And especially with African like music right now, it's like there's always a chosen one to step out of Africa. Mm-hmm. And that your job when you get chosen by, like, the world to go represent your country or mm-hmm. your continent, your job is not to just, like, sit and bask in the glory, you know?
Yeah.
Your job is actually to take, like, a group of 5-6 kids and say, let's go, you know what I'm saying? Even if you don't take them with you overseas, but it's like you still make them hot at home,
yeah,
at least, you know what I'm saying? And all the people that didn't do that, like, actually know it. Like, even after the millions and after all the hits and everything, you'll be like, no way, they're dead, you know?
Wow.
So I don't want to die like that.
Yeah, you don't
want to
go out like that.
No.
So with the song of music, I've seen, like, a lot of videos are on a channel called Makado Makado.
Yeah.
And that is your agency, is it?
Yeah, that's my agency.
So how long has that been going for?
I think since I started rapping, like, I knew that my company was going to be called, like, Makado Makado. Mm-hmm. Makado is my name.
Yeah.
So I was like, it needs to be my name. So I knew whatever company I was going to start was going to be Makado Makado. Music, Makado Makado, barbershop, Makado Makado, yeah. Everything is Makado, yeah. Makado, so that's like my family company.
Yeah. Okay, so we have Riky Rick, and then we have Ricardo Makado.
Yeah.
Like, how different are they? Because obviously, you know, you have your stage persona, yeah. You have the person you are when you're a musician, and then you have you, yeah. When you're not on stage and stuff like that. So, if someone wanted to find out what the difference is, what would you say?
I would say Riky Rick is like, you're speaking to Ricardo Makado right now?
Yes.
I can't bring out Riky Rick for you guys right here in front of cameras. Riky Rick is like a show persona.
It's okay.
Like, it's like a live show.
Mm-hmm. I see.
It's like, it changes, you know what I'm saying? There's like a different concept. When I make music, mm-hmm. I'm Riky Rick, but then, like, this is Ricardo and I'm chill, I can think, I can talk story. This is me, you know? This is like the family man, you know what I'm saying?
Guy, yeah.
Yeah, that's me. But Riky Rick is the guy who's gonna jump on stage and, like, fuck shit up.
And make people mosh pit and shit. Because yeah. I swear, I've seen so many of your videos to your performances and I'm like, oh my God, like...
Yeah.
But we'll get into that. I wanna get into that a lot, but okay. They are absolutely crazy. Now, talk to me about your music, because a lot of people say that you have, like, an infusion of hip hop and white girl music.
Yeah.
How would you describe that as?
I'm a hip hop head, like. I'm a hip hop head, like, by from, like, the earliest memories I have, like, I've loved, like, authentic, like, real hip hop,
yeah.
You know? And then, when I became a producer, I started making beats. It was easier to make Kwaito beats. So Kwaito is like 95 BPM, like, it's like sort of like mid-tempo sort of vibes, like, you know, bassline vibes.
Yeah.
It was easier to make Kwaito beats. Mm-hmm. So, like, I became really good at making Kwaito beats. And then, like, I was like, okay, maybe I should also do Kwaito music at the same time. So I, like, sort of like left rap a little bit and did Kwaito. And then Kwaito blew me up back home. And then I was like, shit, actually, we can actually stick to this Kwaito thing. It wasn't like a plan, but it was like, I can actually keep doing Kwaito the whole time. And then I tried, like, move left and right between hip hop and Kwaito.
Yeah.
So I tried to release different types of songs, different types of crowds.
So you said you're a hip hop head. And, you know, I personally kind of only knew about South African music when it came to house music.
Yeah.
So South African house, that's what I was really familiar with. And you know how in America they always have, like, the old school hip hop artists,
yeah.
Where, you know, even further than Dr. Dre, all those kind of things.
Yeah.
What would it be in that sense in South Africa when it comes to hip hop? Because would it be you guys, like Casper Noy versus you and the rest of the guys, would you guys be the star of hip hop, or was there someone before that?
Wow, there was something before that.
Yeah.
And, like, out of respect to everybody who came before, you know, there was definitely, like, people doing it.
Okay.
But nobody really built nobody had, like, the opportunities that we had in terms of building the scene and making it a scene, making it a vibe. Like, 360, it's not just getting on the mic and rapping.
Yeah.
Because everywhere, there's always cyphers, there's been, that culture's been everywhere, you know, but no one's made like a 360 approach. So when we came, we were fighting like all the OGs that are in the game that didn't want to let us through. And we were fighting like the guys that were chosen by, like, how do I say, like the OGs choose who they want to be successful, you know, and we weren't on that list, you know. So we had to really like carve a scene and figure out how we're going to make this hip hop thing a 360, you know, like a 360 lifestyle for us. And I think like that's what we've been doing. So we might be the beginning, but there's definitely people who started, but nobody finished it. Like I said, like nobody, like there's not like a legendary hip hop label. Exactly.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. I'm trying to. Yeah.
Like we're the first that like created our own labels and made it legendary. Like Casper's got a family tree, and he's got artists like Naden, Kai, Gemini Major, Zeho. You know what I'm saying? I'm part of family tree too. Even though I'm a science family tree, I'm part of it too. Yeah. It's like the same thing, you know. So and this Major League, our other cousins, like we said, like let's build an empire around this music thing. And yeah, we're not doing too bad.
Yeah. So, I mean, let's take it back a little bit.
Yeah.
You've mentioned before that your only album was Family Values.
Yeah.
And you haven't released an album since then.
Yeah.
Now, before that, you had two mixtapes as well.
Yeah.
You had The Comeback Kid last summer.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Then you had your album, and then only this year you come back with Scooby Snacks.
Yeah.
Why was there such a break in between the album and the
and now?
Yeah.
I think I don't really like, you see, like I make music for me.
Yeah.
Like I don't make music like for anybody else really. Like I make it for me, and if I make something that's like a hit or whatever, I'll put it out, you know? But I make music like more of a therapy. So like I really need time to make music. Like other people like can just make music on the road or get into studio and just turn up and make like a few songs. Like for me, like it takes me like months and months to sit and decide if I want to put out music.
Yeah.
So it's like, that's the thing that's been stopping me. Like, I'm not the type of person to just make songs, just to release them. So I want to be known as the artist who can have a 4-year gap and then drop an album, you know? I don't want to be like, people mustn't consider me as a person like, you fell off if you didn't drop a hit.
Yeah, yeah.
And like, a lot of people fall into the trap because everyone's telling you, you're hot right now. Let's go, let's go, let's go. And the only way you can go when you're at the top is like crash, you know? So I want to do this like really slowly and like drop one album every 4 years, you know, or every 3 years. That's good enough for me. Like if you listen to Adele drops an album every 4 years, but she comes back better, you know?
That's
true. For us hip hop guys, it's like every 3 months now there's a mixtape, there's something, and you don't even remember what the guy dropped last year. You know what I'm saying? I don't want that for me.
Do you not feel that the pressure's different though in both scenes? Because you know you spoke about Adele and obviously that kind of pop scene, I guess that kind of mainstream kind of scene, and then you've got hip hop where everyone is kind of feeling like they have to do all these things. Do you not feel like that's probably down to the market?
Yeah, I think with hip hop it's an age thing.
Yeah.
I don't really think it's about the market. I don't think it's really about hip hop itself. It's more of like an age thing because in hip hop there's like the kid keeps getting younger all the time. If you are 25, and the hottest next kid comes out and he's 18, you automatically feel like you need to kick that kid's ass, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But when you're older and you realize that you can't keep competing with everybody and you're actually on your own race, you don't get caught up in that. So like, let's say if I'm like, well for us, like there's nobody really doing the same music I'm making, but if I was like a trap kid, right? It's like, and I was 25 years old, and another one comes and comes like 4 songs. Now, like if I was making the same music as an STC or an MT, right? I would feel pressure to release music right now. So I wouldn't be able to take my time and take this gas because they're burning hot, or Nasty's burning hot at least. So it's like, you start competing with those guys because they're hot. You feel what I'm saying? And you start dropping more, and the more you drop, people realize actually you're too old, you're not the one anymore. You lost this news. I don't want that. Like,
yeah.
I want to make my unique type of music. That's for me and my people. Grow it and kill it like that.
So talking about your music, how did you even get into it? Because you mentioned, you know, you're a producer as well.
Yeah.
Did you start off producing and then go into the music?
I was at film school, so what happened was they were trying to take me to university.
Okay.
Not they were trying to take me to, it was time to go to university.
Okay.
I was like, no, you're not trying to take me to university. What I'm gonna do, I'm gonna go to film school. But like that was just a way to run away from like doing accounting or whatever, right? And then when I end up in film school, then I end up like doing like scores for the film. And then I realized that I could actually like make beats, and then I started like just rapping from there, like rapping on top of my beats that I was making in film school for the movies. And then I was like, actually I can rap instead of doing film.
So I guess we can thank film school.
Yeah, film school is the one.
To it. So
if anybody needs to run away from going to accounting or being a doctor, go to film school. You'll learn something. It's good.
And where you said you grew up in Johannesburg.
Yeah.
And Durban.
Yeah.
Specifically.
Yeah.
Now, would you say that influenced your music?
I think Durban definitely, but like I said, like for me, like half of my life was spent trying to be like Tupac and Mace, you know?
Yeah.
Like that was my, like half of my life was spent trying to be like, be Cameron, you know what I'm saying? That's what I really wanted to be. Yeah. I wanted to be like, you know, one of those guys. So that's, I guess it was a good thing because then I could like listen to like a lot of American hip hop and understand it, but I didn't really want to, like I wasn't looking at the stuff that was being made at home as like my inspiration to make music. It was always like hip hop that side. And then in Durban there was such like a rich culture of music and artists and Joburg especially. And then like when I came home from high school, when I was like thrown into the real world, I realized that actually I could take all my old influences that I didn't want to use and make music with my old influences. And then I was like, okay, that's how we need to do it.
You did mention listening to American artists. Now, one thing we say on the Ubunifu space is we'll listen to South African music, and especially the rappers and stuff, and we'll be like, oh yeah, they sound American. But then we get like a flood of people like, stop saying they sound American. But then it's like, but literally sometimes some artists actually do sound like American. I don't know if it's an accent thing or if it's the influences. What would you pin?
I think for us, because we're so used to it, it's like your guys' accents, like you sound, what do you sound like? British.
You sound British,
right?
We are British, yeah.
But like, so if somebody from Liverpool, right, was like talking to me right now, they would sound different from you, right?
Yeah, correct.
So it's like, but someone in the States would be like, that person from Liverpool, are you from London?
Okay, I get you.
Like you're always from London. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Okay, yeah.
Like when outside people look at it, you're always from London. Whether you're from this part or that part, you're from London. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
So with our guys, when they hear people say that, it's like, it's just like they feel, they understand all those accents.
Okay.
Do you understand? Like my accent is different from Casper's accent, and MT's accent is different. So everyone like raps differently, you know? And AKA's accent is different also. So people are just like different in the way they speak.
Okay, so we would assume that it's all sound like...
For us the change, because the way we speak English, like the way I speak English is not the same way I speak Zulu. Right. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like even if I spoke English like this, people wouldn't know, some people wouldn't know where I'm from. They'd be like, are you from London?
No, I'm
from Johannesburg. And then you say you're from Johannesburg, they ask you, do you speak Afrikaans? Like, no, we don't speak Afrikaans. You understand what I'm saying? It's like that type of vibe.
Yo, I'm trying to catch up. I didn't get it.
So, basically what I'm saying, like, there's so many different accents.
Like, yeah, they don't all sound the same.
That we, for us, we don't sound the same.
Oh, but to someone else, you might sound the same.
For someone else. Okay. But you definitely just stop saying it sounds American.
Isn't that annoying for you though?
Not for me, but it hurts like it hurts people. Like it hurts some people.
Really?
Yeah, because that was a diss. Like that's like a diss. Mm-hmm. Like back home, like it's not America here. You sound American. That's like a diss. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It's like almost like I remember there was a time in UK hip hop when artists sounded a lot like American.
That's true. That is true.
And then. And all the grime guys used to diss the UK hip hop guys.
Yeah.
For sounding like American, you know what I'm saying? And then even some of those hip hop guys, I think they ended up going back to.
Grime. I think they started to come back. It's
like that. So yeah. when we were coming through, we were coming through doing like songs in our own languages, Zulu song. We throw in our language here and there. But if we just rap verses fully American, I mean, Now you see, you got to say American. If you rap versus put in English, it would be a problem.
Yeah.
And now there's even like, there's boom now. Boom is too much. Now boom is actually taking it to the top.
What's boom?
Huh?
What do you say?
Go, okay, do this. Go.
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 Say go. Yeah, almost. So then say go. No, no, no.
Oh.
No. Like this. No. Go, not N. Go.
Go.
Thank you.